host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Good evening, good evening. Welcome to WDC Radio. I'm your host. I am WDC. You can follow me on Twitter and Instagram at IamWDC. Also sitting next to me, the one and only. Thank you for tuning in today. It's Earth Day, so make sure you do your part. Take care of this only planet that we have here. So, you know, make sure you do your part. Recycle.
I always recycle.
All right. Just checking. All right, so this is WDC Radio, Sickle Cell Trait Awareness. I have a very special show for you today. I have a fellow advocate who I met, social media powerful. Actually, she was in D.C. with us on Advocacy Day, and so she's here to share her story living with sickle cell and her experience on Advocacy Day with her. She also has her husband with her, Kenny. He's going to be here as well. I want to acknowledge him for being a support system for her. A lot of the caregivers and husbands, spouses don't get that. So we like to do that here on our show to make sure that those spouses get acknowledged for their support. So we'll be right back. This is the theme song. It's on iTunes. What's the Count? Curtis Blow, you heard. Young Ice and IG The Great. We'll be right back.
All my life I've been a fighter. Greatest upset in history, noted the sports writer. Put me in the Olympics, I'm guaranteed I'm the torchlighter. Provider of all the lyrics that are blowing scorch fire. I'm in the locker room, getting my ass tamed. Thinking speed of a cheater, the strength of a man. Hey, I'm feeling bad what I'm about to do to this man's face. But he the opponent, so I'm on the loss I can't take. Hands like Mayweather, swag like Ali. You think you way better, homie, than I see. And then I think they call me Hitman, Tommy Hearns. And y'all be biting like Tyson, I learn. And I don't gotta be flashy in front of the camera. All I do is show my warrior heart like Evander. Never been knocked out, but I've been knocked down. Long as I make it to the next round, what's the count?
All right, again, welcome back. This is WDC Radio. You can follow us right now. We're live, streaming live on DC Talk Live, Las Vegas Talk Live, New York Talk Live.
I don't know that.
Oakland Talk Live. Also on Ustream on the LA Talk Live. Also iTunes Radio under R&B LA Talk Live. We're more than just talk. Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. Totally ready.
I'm not going to tell you what she was drinking earlier because they ain't sponsored the show, but she's on one right now. She done had something that was hype.
Hey, I'm all 100.
All right, so this is WDC Radio. We're going to get the show started. Okay. Thank you for tuning and listening in. Before I get started, I just want to thank all the advocates that came out to Advocacy Day in D.C. on the Hill with us. I appreciate you. My roommate, shouts out to Tyrone for coming out. I actually had a little influence. I appreciate them for trusting me. Mm-hmm. He drove from New York. Our guest drove from North Carolina. And
I wanted to go.
When I talked to Tyrone, I found out I was the only male. So I was like, hey, I got to get some more men out here. So I put some feelers out there, and Tyrone came. And so I appreciate him. Tyrone, I'm going to do a special show for you. Tyrone lost his brother just last month to sickle cell. They both have sickle cell disease. So his brother passed at 34, a young age. So I'm going to do a special show for him and his brother next month. So stay tuned for that. And again, just being on the Hill, that's my second time being on Advocacy Day, talking to Barbara Boxer's office, Dianne Feinstein's office, Pete Aguilera. We coming for you guys. And interesting. We'll talk more about that during the show. Let me bring on the guest so we can get the show started, because I know her husband is, Kenny's got to go to work. So, hello, are you there?
Hello.
Hey, how you doing?
Hello, both of you. Thank you both. How are you?
Pretty good.
I am doing well.
Doing well. Good. Thank you for accepting the invitation to come on WDC Radio to share your story living with sickle cell. This platform was created for our community to bring more awareness, a greater awareness to sickle cell trait, but also you can't talk about sickle cell trait without talking about sickle cell disease, which is one of the results and the impact of having those two genes when they come together in a child. So again, thank you for coming here and being open to share your experience. So introduce yourself to the listeners, and then we'll get the show started.
Baby, you want to go first?
As you've introduced myself, I'm Kenneth Ritchie. I am a husband to Nakia, a father of two, advocate, and a support system for her as well. So, and that pretty much sums up.
Nakia, who is this guy for you? Tell us.
Oh, man, this guy is my rock. Like, he is my Superman. He is my everything. Like, that is my baby. He's my heart, my best friend. Just everybody, everything I've ever wanted in a man, everything I ever thought I would never get in a man. So, you know, I thank God for him. I thank God for him. He is a blessing to me.
Thank you. Thank you for sharing that. Kenny, when I met you a couple nights ago, man, we just connected. And I could see you as a support system. I saw how you cared, how you listened. And I just want to thank you, man, for stepping up and being responsible for another human being the way you are, man. We know that marriages can be difficult just alone, and then you add other complications to it. You know, I thank you, man. I guess words can't even describe the gratitude and appreciation to see you be there as a support system for her. We appreciate it. All right. Introduce yourself, ma'am.
Okay. I am Nakia Newbin Ritchie. No, my name is not hyphenated, but I keep that Newbin in there to keep it real to my family and to represent for them. I am 35 years old. I will be 36 in July. Woo woo. Yeah. you know, a lot of people like to hide their age. That's something I've never done. When you live a life that, you know, they kind of put labels on your years and tell you how many years you might live, and I was given the age 18.
Wow.
So every year for me is a blessing, and I thank God to be here at 35. I am an advocate, a mother, a college student, a wife, of course, and a entrepreneur trying to get a business started, trying to get a nonprofit organization started.
Okay.
Just got my hands in a lot of pots and, you know, just trying to make it do what it do for the sickle cell community.
All right. We're going to unfold all that in this hour here. I wanted to start off with both of you on the line, because I just want the listeners to understand, you know, having a relationship with someone living with sickle cell, Kenny, what was it that you saw in her that you was like, you know what, we're going to take this on together?
Honestly, it was a process. For me, it was day by day,
yeah,
month by month, and just learning, not just her, but just learning more about the disease. And like most people, my introduction to sickle cell, or the awareness, or what it was, of course, was the VH1 special with TLC.
Yes.
With a little piece with T-Bots.
Right.
And that was my, because until then, until I saw that special, I was like, sickle who? What is that? And so I got a little glimpse of what it is and what it was. So when I met Nakia, seeing some of the pain that she was in and going through some of the things that she had to go through, it was a learning process. Now, as far as me, our connection, our relationship, it like I said, it just grew day by day.
Right.
It grew very quickly. Let's just add that.
It was a process.
Okay.
I mean, to sum it up, it was a process of learning, process of each other, but just of learning her and what she had to deal with.
Exactly.
And that was pretty much it. So.
And Nakia, what's your point of view on that?
Well, he's right. You know, it was a process, but he was open-minded. By the time I got to him, I was so frustrated with men and just the whole going around in circles and all that foolishness. I was like, look, this is what it is. I got sickle cell. This is what I go through. If you can't handle it, roll out now.
Straight off the top.
She was very, and believe it or not, her dad had this little joke. He would call the 90 day, fill in the blank.
Oh, okay.
And, because basically it was
nobody was, never made it past 90 days.
Wow.
And it was basically someone, she would get sick, they would disappear.
Yeah.
And so when I came along, and it was like 9 days, I'm still around. They're like, okay, who's the dude? But like I said, it was a process. And just being open-minded, understanding that, we are all human.
Definitely.
And that we all have ups and downs, whether you have sickle cell, whether you just have emotional dysfunction. We all deal with something.
Exactly.
And understanding that we all deal with something in some part of our lives, you just grow with that person, and you just accept, their flaws and their and everything. So it was just, like I said, it was a process. And was it 11 years later? Oh, yeah. Almost 12 years later, here we are. So
I don't want to hold you too much longer, but just tell me, what was your experience at Advocacy Day?
My experience, it was eye-opening, just learning how our democracy works.
Yes.
Well, supposed to work anyway. but being able to just be in that setting with the senators and the congressmen and all of you guys, the advocates and the people with sickle cell that were there fighting for their rights to be treated fairly, to get extra treatment facilities and different things that are needed within the sickle cell community was very educational, and it was eye-opening. I also met a lot of great people.
Yes,
who I would like to see again. I think that we shouldn't wait until we have another bill on the floor of Congress.
Exactly, right?
It should be an annual thing. Because
exactly.
There's other things that are vying in Washington every year,
right?
And they fight every year, not just when we have something on the floor.
Exactly.
But we need to do this. I think it should be an annual thing. So
I appreciate you. Thank again. You guys drove. I mean, she told me what was going on. I mean, at first of all, she accepted my invitation. Like, we were talking about you guys were going on vacation, all these different things that she had lined up.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, look, if you can make it, make it. Then the day you were leaving, all the complications that happened. And you guys still drove there. And I, again, thank you for trusting me and even being open to come across a few states.
Yeah.
Very important.
It's right up the road, so.
Okay, well, thank you. Thank you for calling in. Thank you for your time. And I look forward to speaking to you more often, too.
All right.
Pleasure meeting you. All right, Nakia, you ready?
Yes, sir, I am.
All right, so I'd like to start this conversation off with you with some sickle cell trait awareness. Did your parents know that they both carry the sickle cell trait gene?
No, they did not. My mother knew. However, my father did not know, which the fact that he was in the military, it was very ironic to me that they would not know that with him, with all the stuff they do to prepare you to go into the military.
Right.
So being that my father did not know, they came together and got married and, of course, had a child, and they didn't know until after I was born about him having the trait.
Right.
And so...
And that's a familiar conversation. That's my conversation, because I didn't find out until I was in the military for 10 years before I found out on the second physical. So it happens, unfortunately or fortunately. Some of us didn't get that blood work done, I guess.
Yeah, kind of fall through the cracks a little bit.
Yeah,
but,
it happens.
After me, they definitely decided not to have any more children.
Okay.
You know, that was a decision that they made to stop the sickle cycle.
Okay. Now, what can you remember growing up as a little girl that your mom or your parents shared with you that this is who you are and you're going to be living with this disease?
I really don't remember them telling me a whole lot. I really remember learning a lot at the doctor's office, like, you know, going to doctor's visits and listening to what the doctors had to say. And I was always one that was very on top of my care, always wanted to learn more. I would always ask a lot of questions, and, you know, I wouldn't just let them do any and everything. You know, I'd be like, okay, what's that? What are you about to do with that? Okay, how many milligrams is that? Okay, what's the side effects of that? You know, and I just always made myself very aware of what was going on, and that's basically how I learned.
Yeah.
You know, I learned by just asking questions. And you know, my parents, when I would ask questions, they would, of course, answer to the best of their knowledge. And when they needed information, they did the same thing. They asked questions, did research, whatever they needed to do to find out the information.
What was that first crisis like for you?
Oh, man. That first crisis for me was scary. I was 5 years old.
Wow.
And we were actually on vacation in Jacksonville, Florida, with my cousins, and we were in I was in a swimming pool, and all I can remember is kicking my legs in the inner tube. I was just having a blast, man. I was talking this big brown inner tube that I had, and I'm floating, and I'm kicking. Well, when I get out the pool, my legs started hurting really bad.
Oh, wow.
And I told my mom, said, Mom, mommy, my legs are hurting. And, you know, at first she just thought that, you know, it might have been just a little cramp or something.
Right.
So then as I kept complaining, that's when her and my dad realized, okay, this is something that's more serious, you know. So I had to be taken to their local emergency room.
Oh, wow.
There, you know, they gave me some medications, and I was not admitted to the hospital at that time. And I think they probably would have admitted me, but the doctor asked me a question. He said, do you feel better, or do you think you need a shot in the butt?
yeah, I'm way better.
A question like that. I said, oh, no, I feel better. I can go home.
So, no shots.
You know, that was my first experience, and I can remember going back to my cousin's house and, you know, my mom and dad taking care of me, and just, you know, I can just remember having, just laying in the bed and watching cartoons. And
wow.
At that time, there was the alphabet people, the letter people, and they put on Miss E, and Miss E was singing, you got to exercise, and telling me that, you know, you got to get strong so you can exercise with Miss E.
Right.
So that's my memory of it, literally.
Wow. Okay, we're going to go fast forward. I think SCTD may have a question for you.
Huh?
Okay.
hold on, I wasn't expecting.
We're going to start in the younger age. So how was it growing up in elementary school? How was living with sickle cell with that?
Growing up in elementary school, I always wanted to, you know, I didn't want others to know that I had sickle cell. I was very ashamed of it. You know, that was something that I tried to keep a secret.
Okay, hold on. All right, here we go. What was the shame? What were you dealing with at such a young age?
Yeah, at a young age, because I wanted to be quote-unquote normal.
Ah.
I wanted to be like every other kid.
Yeah.
I didn't want to be set apart and known as being different.
Okay.
Because we all know what it's like to get that different kid that comes that's handicapped or that different. You know, you just don't want to be in that category.
Right.
You know, you want to be one of the cool kids just like everybody else.
Right.
So that was something that I tried to hide. And my parents would go to the school every single year to talk to my teachers. Why they went on the first day, I don't know. But they always went on the first day and pulled my teachers to the side and said, you know, because I don't know why they had these stupid rules that you can't go to the bathroom more than such and such times.
Oh, yeah.
I had to be able to hydrate myself.
Right.
I needed to be able to go to the water fountain. I needed to be able to go to the bathroom when needed, because if you're drinking throughout the day, you're going to have to go to the bathroom. So I had to have certain exceptions.
Right.
So, you know, then I can remember in fifth grade, they made allowances where I could have water in the classroom.
Oh, wow.
I was in Germany at the time. And my parents would buy bottled water and juice and put it in the refrigerator in the class, and
wow.
I was able to drink it during class. And, you know, I was able to have exemptions from PE. Like, I could do PE, but it was certain things that were too strenuous that I wasn't able to do.
But besides the swimming pool, what did you notice as a trigger with the exercise? What was the trigger for you?
As a child, or
yeah, as a child, yeah, that you.
As a child, I guess it was, you know, when I would I noticed that when we would go, I couldn't get in beach water. You know, beach water would trigger a crisis for me. I noticed that, you know, doing too much, getting overexerting myself.
Yeah.
Like, I would go, and then I would just get exhausted. And I just couldn't do all the running and all the other things that the kids did. It would just exhaust me, and that's right. What I would notice would trigger my crises.
Okay.
What's your happy place?
What's my happy place?
Yes.
Well, I like to write. I write poetry. That allows me to get my emotions out. It allows me to vent. I like to laugh. I like to joke. Anything funny. I like to make people laugh. I like to act silly.
That's one of
the biggest kids you'll ever meet. You know, so, you know, I'm just that person that I'm really high on life. And a lot of times people say, okay, what's wrong with her? Even my 11-year-old son will say, mommy, my mama just don't get out much.
So growing, you know, at this age in fifth grade, you know, sixth grade, what was going on, you know, mentally, since you were kind of ashamed? How did you deal with that stress at just such a young age? Like, you was obviously aware that you didn't want to say these, you know, talk about your disease. So how did you let that out?
I guess I didn't. You know, I just tried to blend in as much as possible. I tried to do as many activities with the other kids as much as possible. You know, if I could fast forward a little bit to seventh grade.
Yeah, let's go.
Okay, in seventh grade, you know, because first of all, my crisis didn't start really bad. I had that one at five,
yeah.
But they didn't start really bad till I was 11 when we were living in Germany.
Okay.
And the weather conditions are very harsh over there. I was never supposed to be there in the first place. So we had to get PCS back to the States. So my dad's tour ended at 15 and a half months. And he was glad. He didn't like Germany anyway, so
yeah.
It was all good for him.
I didn't like
so
it
we got back to the States. I get back in school here. And, you know, seventh grade, you know, I'm trying to be normal, trying to go along with all the other students. And every year my parents would tell them, she's sensitive about this. Please don't tell the other kids.
Right.
Well, you know, my admissions started getting more and more frequent to where I would be, you know, out of school like almost every month.
Right.
You know, and, you know, kids started questioning, what happened to you? What was wrong with you? And I would make something up. Oh, I had the flu. Oh, I had pneumonia. You know, I just make stuff up.
Right.
And so one particular admission, I was gone, came back to school. The teacher had told the entire class.
Oh, wow.
Boy, I was hot. And I just said, I cannot believe this. And the kids were just questioning me. you got sickle cell, and I can just still hear them all asking me, wow. you got sickle cell, and I said, no. I said, who told you that? The teacher told us that. I said, she's lying.
Wow.
You know, I said, I don't know where she got that from. You know, so I was so hurt, you know, because it was something that was not supposed to be discussed.
Right.
And, you know, the fact that she told the whole class like that while I was gone, it just really, hurt me.
But did you feel any sense of like, relief of, like, finally I don't have to hide it anymore? Did you feel any of that not at the time?
Not at that point.
Yeah.
It wasn't until, I guess, ninth grade that I started becoming open, because I had to get a port. And,
oh, wow.
You know, I got my first port when I was 14.
Okay.
So, of course, you know, the scar was low, but, you know, it was still visible in certain shirts.
Yeah.
So I began to start explaining and things to people. So I came to grips with it and came to terms with it, I'd say, high school. So by the time I got to high school, I just started explaining it to people. And I started letting them know, look, this is what it is. This is what I have. And, you know, sometimes I'm going to be sick. Sometimes I'm in the hospital. But, you know, once I get out, it's all good. I'm still the same, the kid. You know, I still like to wild out, have fun, you know, or whatever. And once I started being honest with people, it was like, you know, it wasn't such a big deal.
Yeah.
Because what I learned was that if you try to hide things and make it a secret, people will make a bigger deal of it than what it really is.
Yeah.
But once you become open with it, it's like, oh, okay. You know, it's no big deal.
Yeah. I know, and that not just when you have sickle cell, but it could be any, you know, thing in life, you know, owning that situation, owning your life is turns out to be a lot of freedom and peace of mind in that, when you own, you know, who you are.
Exactly.
What was, before we take a commercial break here, give me a couple of stigmas that you heard growing up that you just want disappeared.
I guess it wasn't so much growing up, but it was more as I got older.
Okay.
The stigmas that I heard were that, you know, we were all drug addicts, that we're all lazy, we just want attention, we're drama queens.
Yeah.
You know, stuff like that, you know, that really hurt on the inside, because it just felt like people just didn't understand, you know, and just trying to get them to understand, trying to explain, it's just taxing and tiring mentally.
Exactly.
Because, you know, just trying to over and over get people to understand what you're going through. And I just got to the point where it's like, all right, you know, if you don't understand, you don't understand. I'll try my best to explain it to you, but it's not my responsibility to try to make you understand how I feel.
Exactly. And we you and I talked about this earlier, that some of these stigmas actually, you know, hurt people so much that they take their lives because of these stigmas, and how hurtful the impact it is on our community.
Yeah, so, I mean, mentally it can be very painful. I've battled with depression, anxiety, you know, things like that, and it's just something that, you know, you have to learn to deal with, and you have to learn coping mechanisms.
Exactly.
So that you can be a healthier you.
Exactly. All right, we're going to take it a step further in a minute. We're going to take a quick break, so don't go nowhere. Again, thank you for tuning and listening in. This is WDC Radio. I'm your host. I'm WDC. Got SCTD over here with the two fingers up. Dancing.
We're going to take it a step further in a minute.
All right, so we'll be right back. LA Talk Live. More than just talk.
We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Xavier Tees and Tots, groundbreaking fashion, forward street smart designs. Tees and Tots for men, women, and boys. Visit XavierUSA.com. Once again, that's XavierUSA.com.
Women now make up 37% of the workforce, changing their role forever.
Harvard Medical School has now opened its doors to new female applicants.
The first woman is now in space.
The majority of last year's doctorate degrees were earned by women.
We've come so far, but our news is changing for the worse. More women die from heart disease and stroke than men, even though it can be prevented. Make a change at GoRedForWomen.org today. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the American Heart Association's Go Red for Women.
Hey, hey, shout us out. What's the count? Tune in to WDC Radio with me, Farron Dozier, your host, a.k.a. IMWDC, on Wednesdays, 7 p.m. Pacific, 10 p.m. Eastern, as we cover aspects of sickle cell trait, interviews with doctors, nurses, caregivers, and those living with sickle cell. So be sure to tune in every Wednesday, 7 p.m. Pacific, on WDC Radio, exclusively here on LA Talk Live, where we're more than just talk.
Hi, this is Gloria Williams, inviting you to join me every Saturday, 5 p.m. Pacific, for the Branding Foot Nanny Show. Join me as I freestyle interview and discuss how to make your business a brand. So don't forget to tune in to the Branding Foot Nanny Show every Saturday, 5 p.m. Pacific, exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Radio Flag, TuneIn Radio, Live 365, or just watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening and viewing pleasure. This is LA Talk Live. I am the Foot Nanny, and we are more than just talk.
Welcome back. This is WDC Radio. I'm your host from WDC. SCTD's in the building. All right, is Kenny still on the line?
Yeah, I'm here. I'm still here.
I want to ask you, man, when you experienced that first crisis with her, what were you thinking? Like, what was that experience for you?
The very first time, it was, like I said, I was still in learning mode, yeah. So... I always had her dad kind of in the background, and what taught me was watching him. And because basically he was her voice when she could not talk. And so watching how he handled the nurses, how he handled the doctors, and then as time went on, I just learned more of what she was feeling, what she was going through. And then, as you know, as time goes on, you start learning the medical jargon. So when the nurses come in with a little coded conversations,
right,
start messing with trying to play doctor and trying to change orders, like, no, you're not going to do that. You're going to leave them settings right there, you know, and let her be. And so, but the very first time, like I said, it was a learning experience. Like I said, of course, I had her dad, and like I said, I was, you know, for a while, I just kind of watched him.
Yeah.
And that's basically how.
How did you, emotionally, to see her in such pain?
It hurts somebody, you know, it hurts to watch somebody hurt, you know, especially, you know, somebody you love that, you know, is watching them hurt, and there's really nothing you can do for them.
Yes.
You know, or, you know, and it's like, what can I do but just, you know, support in any way possible, whether it's, you know, fussing with the nurse, fussing with the doctor, you know, whatever you got to do to help her, you know, get out of pain.
Right.
And sometimes it's not easy, you know. Sometimes, you know, it's frustrating because, you know, you have to sometimes step back and go along with the program in the sense of, okay, if, you know, they just administered this, you know, you, as much as you want them to go, you know, time to go by so she can get some more medication or whatever the case may be.
Yeah.
Sometimes you just have to just sit down and just relax.
Yeah. Thank you. Nikia, you and I talked again earlier, and how we talked about, you know, the compassion for ourselves when we're in pain, but also the compassion for the support system that we have around us, but and also the compassion for the doctors and nurses at the same time. And a lot of time when we're in, you know, when you're in pain or the person's in pain, you know, compassion is out the window. What can you speak to that part of this conversation as far as, you know, realizing in yourself that, you know, the people around you, to have compassion for them as well in the midst of all that?
Well, like I was telling you earlier, I've always had a very good support system. Like, my mom and dad were, like, and still are, my rock. It's him, it's my husband and my parents. That's my team. You know, and they've always been very supportive. And it wasn't until I had children of my own that I understood what my parents have been through all my life. And there's been times that I've just called my parents crying and apologizing to them for being selfish. Because I said, you know, Mom and Dad, I said, it's you know, for you guys, I just didn't understand, because it was just about me. Because I said I was the one that was hurting. I was the one feeling the pain. But I didn't realize how it's impacting and affecting their lives.
Exactly.
You know, because as a parent, you want what's best for your child. You know, you're trying to do what's best for your child as much as possible. But at the same time, you have a life too. And their lives were totally put on hold for me.
Exactly.
You know, trips that were canceled, events that they couldn't make, things that they had to miss out on in life because they had a sick child. And, you know, now that I have children, for one, I just couldn't even imagine, first of all, my child going through, having to watch my child in that type of pain.
Exactly.
And, you know, I just never realized how much it affected them. And such. I used to see my dad cry. I used to see my mom cry at times, you know, and I just, you know, and I knew they were upset, and I didn't like to see them cry, but still, it took me back to me.
Right.
I'm the one hurting, you know, and we just have to sometimes take a step back and get our eyes off of ourselves and look at others that are supporting us. And, you know, on the same note, like I was telling you, some people don't have good support systems.
Right.
They don't have people that are there for them, you know, and so I can understand how they would very much feel the me factor.
Of course.
Feel isolated.
I mean, to speak to our community, you know, Just to kind of relate to that conversation, you know, even the doctors and nurses, I've been told that from nurses and doctors that, you know, I hurt taking care of the patients because I feel like I'm failing them, because I'm giving them this medication, I'm doing what they need me to do, and they're still in pain. So there's an impact on the nurses, even though they're professionals, they're still people, and there's, you know, they feel that, some of them feel that, you know, they take it on as well, the pain and the suffering, and it hurts them.
And I'm glad you said some of them, because, you know, there's a percentage of them that are like that, and then you have a whole nother percentage of them who, and I think that my warriors that are listening right now really want me to focus on this, because I've been noticing that a lot of us have been experiencing a lack of compassion and a lack of understanding.
Yes.
From the doctors and the nurses lately.
Yes.
You know, just a lot of times going into the ER, most of us will sit at home till the very, very last minute and hurt so bad. There's times my husband has to make me go, because
yeah.
I'm just like, I don't want to go. I don't want to have to deal with the fight. I know I'm going to have a fight on my hands when I get there. And a lot of us have been dealing with that. You go and you don't get the treatment you need. They think you're an addict. They think you're just there for pain medicine. What they don't realize is that, for one, we have more than enough medicine at home, and it isn't until it gets to the point where the pain is so excruciating that our oral medications are not working.
Right.
To where we have to go to the hospital. So, you know, and there's, you know, to go through, you know, how they try to say sometimes, oh, we're faking, or we just want an attention, we just want to be at the hospital. None of us want to be at the hospital.
Right.
You know, none of us just want to be there to go through that, because truth be told, I've even told doctors this, I will go somewhere and get me a dime bag of weed before I sit here and go through this. That's not my desire.
Where's
you know,
Snoop?
I don't desire that. That's not something I do. You know, I said, but before I go through this, if that was the case,
exactly.
hear me, well, community, if that was the case, that's what I would do. Because why? Why sit here and go through the foolishness when $10 can get me feeling right?
Exactly.
You know, so that's not my desire.
Thank you.
All I want is to feel better and to do it the right way. You know, it's just the treatment. There's a lack of understanding. One of the things that is most frustrating about our treatment is that many of us have a high tolerance for pain medication.
Right.
Because we've been on these medications for years and years and years. This is a lifelong disease, so this is not something that just happened a year or two ago. It's not something that just happened, you know. And so for being on medications for years, you know, you do build a tolerance.
Yeah.
And what I try to explain to people is that there's a difference between tolerance and addiction.
Exactly.
Between dependency and addiction.
Exactly.
And
small percentage get addicted. Small percentage get addicted. Small percentage.
Yeah, a very small percentage. But because it's a very small percentage that get addicted, they like to throw all of us in that same category.
Right.
And it's very painful, especially when you're in a crisis at a level 9, 10, and you're hurting, and all you know is that you need, the only thing that can get you out of pain is God himself and this doctor that has the ability to either approve or deny the medicine that he's going to give you.
You know, thank you for being open and sharing that with the community, because it's a very important topic, and it's something that I think the community as a group of us, we have to address, you know, those conversations in the hospital about that, because your tolerance is high, and just because your tolerance is high, you know, I did a conference with one guy, and he said, you know, as a doctor, he says, take care of the pain first. Don't worry about the addiction, you know, take care of the pain first, because you want to get that patient comfortable, you know, and manageable. So I think SCTD has a question for you.
Yes, ma'am.
How did I say this? Did you ever, like, wish you could, like, have a normal life and not go through this situation?
Oh, many times. Many times. Many times I wished I had a normal life. Many times I wished that I didn't have to endure the pain, that I could just be like the rest of my friends. And, you know, I've told the younger generation of warriors that they're so blessed to have the technology that they have, to have Facebook and Instagram, Twitter, all these things where you have the support groups online, and at any given moment you can log on, and most of us are up because we don't really sleep at night.
We don't sleep. Team, so, no sleep.
You know, it's always somebody up, somebody to reach out to. We didn't have that growing up. You know, we just had to deal with it, and most of us growing up felt like we were the only one.
Exactly.
So, you know, to know that there's hundreds, thousands of us, you know, going through the same thing. You know, I used to think that it was a personal attack on me.
Yeah.
And I used to say, you know, why? Now, what is it about me? You know, why are they just attacking me? And when I started getting in the support groups, and I realized, wow, I hear another sister or brother that's going through the same thing.
Right.
You know, they're not getting the medicine that they need as well. You know, and sometimes it's not that the doctors are not giving us medicine at all. They're giving it to us, but the dosage is not high enough to control the pain.
And that's, again, the what I like about, you know, having this platform, this show, is because it shows that this is a common conversation from California across the country, that obviously there's something going on with if the experience is the same across the country and individuals with this disease. You know, so something's going on, and who's going to take that on? I guess that's going to have to be us as advocates and patients, you know, to come together. Is Kenny still on the line? I want to ask one more question. Is he?
Yes, sir.
Okay, knowing that, you know, that she's living with sickle cell disease, and we know, again, some of these conversations that happen in the hospitals of having kids and the complications that could come from having kids. You know, real quick, how did you guys, you know, have this talk about taking a chance because of what could be the results of her having, you know, a child?
Well, the first thing was, you know, and this is something I encourage everybody who's listening, if you're dating somebody or you're getting serious with somebody, it takes a simple finger prick. Okay, it's a simple test. You get the results in like 15 minutes. And that's basically what we did. We went to our local sickle cell agency, and they took a little prick of and some blood, and they got my results, and I didn't have the trait, so I knew my status.
Yeah.
And especially in the African-American community, we always talk about knowing your status and usually referring to HIV.
Exactly.
But we need to extend that to knowing your status, sickle cell trait,
yeah,
or sickle cell disease. So I encourage everybody to know your status. Because this is something that could be prevented, just like HIV, but we can prevent from others going through the pain disease by simply getting tested.
Yeah.
And it, like I said, it's not hard. It just go. You actually, you can, when you go to your doctor's appointments, wherever, you can
ask for it.
Medical treatment. You can ask, say, look, I just want to know my status. And they'll test you for sickle cell.
And we suggest here on this on our platform the electrophoresis, because it will determine more than just sickle cell trait. It'll pick up the other hemoglobinopathies like C trait, thalassemia, D. So there, yeah, you know, we want people to know to ask. You know, our campaign is what's in your genes. So if you know what's in your genes, then you can, you know, when you have that conversation, then you know those questions can be answered. So thank you for sharing that.
Yeah, and I just want to say that, you know, so that was like the first step. And then, of course, we had the conversation. Then it went on to speaking with her her gynecologist and her medical doctors on what the plan was going to be. So
right,
that's basically the path we took to child having children.
Thank you. Nakia?
Yes, sir?
Your point of view on that, what was that like for you, knowing...
Well, my thing is, you know, I had been told my entire life I could not have kids, all my life long. So my thing was, I'm a very strong-minded, strong-willed person. My thing was like, you know what? I'm gonna try regardless. You know, I could care less what y'all have to say about it. You know, my mother had always told me that you can have kids. She said you need to stop listening to the doctors, listen to your mama.
Right.
So I said, okay, Mom, but, you know, I hear you, but when you got this many doctors telling you you can't have kids, it's like, you know, you kind of start to wonder. And, you know, when we, you know, I knew it had to be planned. That was their main thing, because I was on the hydroxyurea. They told me I needed to be off of that at least 3 to 6 months before conception.
Right.
So I stopped that, and, you know, we started trying as soon as we got married. We started trying right away, and to my surprise, we were married in August. I was pregnant in September, you know, so it was quite scary, you know, because I thought it was going to take years. I had I had even asked my sister to be a surrogate mother for me.
Wow.
You know, it was just that real to me.
Wow. Thank you. Thank you for being open and sharing that. And as a result, you have two beautiful children.
Yes, sir. Two handsome boys.
So... Who is Nakia today? I know as an advocate, you know, you've been inspired by our community. There's something inside of you. What is that leadership that you see? What are you doing in the community today to bring awareness?
Well, right now I'm trying to start up a nonprofit organization for sickle cell people with sickle cell, as well as the trait. The thing that I'm doing is I'm trying to write a book as well. I'm in school for social work. I would like to get my master's degree in social work so that I can be able to maximize my resources and mm-hmm. help others as much as I can on the platform that I'm trying to use. Also, I make jewelry. I do awareness jewelry, and not just for sickle cell. I make awareness jewelry for anybody who has a cause that is important to them and near and dear to their heart. So my jewelry line is called Hand of Hope, and that's what I try to do, is offer a hand of hope to somebody, you know, to help them, and you know, through prayer and faith, to just make things better for everybody all the way around.
Thank you. And what do you want the world to know about sickle cell?
I just, you know, more than anything, want them to know how excruciating the pain can be. You know, this thing is hard at times. You know, the pain, you know, one time I read a research study that said that sickle cell pain can be more excruciating than that of cancer and labor pain.
Mm-hmm.
And I've never had cancer before, but I have had two children, and I can attest to this. I have had crises that were worse than my labor pain.
Wow.
And that's what I think people just don't get it. You know, they don't understand the severity of the pain. And it's not that the pain is severe every single day. Like every time we say we're hurting, we're in that type of pain on that degree.
Yeah.
But I'm talking about when it does get to that level.
Okay.
You know, and it's an emergency situation. You know, I've had times where I've had to be rushed to the hospital by ambulance because it's just that bad.
Wow. Thank you. Kenny, you still there?
Yeah, I'm there.
What, as a husband and a caregiver and a I mean, a male that mm-hmm. took on this with your partner, what mm-hmm. do you want to say to the men who are, you know, it may be in a relationship or on the edge of maybe choosing to have a relationship with someone with sickle cell? What do you want them to know about?
I just say educate yourself, continue educating yourself about sickle cell. I also would say have more of an understanding. Mm-hmm. And that it's not easy, but you just have to understand. And if it takes you putting yourself in that person's shoes,
yeah,
the best way you can, try to, and compassion, and then of course love.
Yeah.
But the main thing is, like I said, just educate yourself about what your spouse, your girl, is going through. Just that's the best advice I can give.
Thank you.
Just, you know, the more you know, the more you can do.
Thank you. And I want to say is a lot of things we take personal, and mm-hmm. I'm sure she's been in a lot of pain, and she probably says some things that creates arguments and triggers, you know. But if I think if we learn how to have a conversation and not take things personal and react, I think
yeah.
a lot of that stuff could really disappear. Because that's how you, like you say, have some compassion, because you're not going to take it personal. Like, why are you lashing out at me? Like, but that's what we usually go to when there's a disagreement or an argument. It's like, what did I do? And maybe it has nothing to do with you. Maybe that yeah. person is just in pain. You know?
You two are like my favorite couples.
Aww, so
seriously,
sweet.
I can't wait to find someone who would accept that I have. Honestly, you two are my favorite.
Wow. Thank you.
Nakia, I know you have a poem, and I want to make sure you have time to share your poem. So before you share it, did I miss anything? Is there something that you want to say to our community to inspire them, to give them, you know, I don't want to say surviving with sickle cell. I like to say living with it, because when you own this, it becomes just who you are. It doesn't define you. So what do you say before you read your poem?
I just want to tell myself, sisters and cell brothers, be strong, keep the faith, you know, find that happy place. You know, rely on God to bring you through this. I want you all to know you're not alone, that there is somebody, a whole community of people out here. I'm here. If you all ever need me, you hit me up. There's others, countless others out there that you can hit them up. We're in this thing together. You know, you're not in this fight alone, and that's what I want them to know. You know, this is not, sickle cell doesn't have to be a death sentence. You know, you can live a productive,
exactly,
prosperous life with sickle cell.
Exactly.
And, you know, I just want them to know that you don't have to give up. Have hope, have faith. You know, continue to fight. Just know that you're not alone. And furthermore, know that we have a Father in heaven who knows all about our troubles, who knows all about our pains, mm-hmm. all about our sicknesses and diseases, and he is still a healer.
Yep. I was given a message a couple of years ago that God never said that the cure was in medicine.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
You know, by his stripes we're healed. So if we believe that he healed back then, and then it all applies today still.
Amen.
Same belief. It's a different time frame. All right, so you got 5 minutes before the show ends. You ready for your you ready?
I'm ready.
All right, you queued up. Let's go.
Okay.
Give me 1 second.
All right. You good, SCTD? You got any more questions for
me? I'm good. You good? I'm good. I said what I wanted to say.
All right.
Excuse me as I testify. No need to have an alibi. I swear by this and declare by this. The basis of this thesis is informative and relative. As I inform you of this narrative, it's part of me. Let me give you some clarity of how this became to be. It started as a defense of something that was intense. Malaria, it was scaring us. Fear and death, it was killing us. But now what I gained is even more pain, because now every day I try to maintain, day by day, anyhow and any way, all types of therapy for the survival of this condition. Not to mention the disrespect and lack of attention. Boy, I'm feeling this tension as I have to rise to every occasion, defending myself by persuasion. Why do I have to try so hard to prove? With every inch of me, I'm in pain. I'm in pain if I'm still, I'm in pain if I move, trying to resist the urge to go off. This pain persists more than whooping cough. A life often full of stress and strife all on its own. So no need to assist me in making this even harder, because what you don't realize is that I'll still survive. Maya Angelou put it best when she said, still I'll rise. This is no surprise. My forefathers been here before me. They led me for me and set the path for my victory. I'm victorious. Even though some have straight declared war on us, no defeat, no battle. I have to battle all the time. The way I've had to fight should be a straight up crime. I'm on the scene and it's by choice. I do it boldly so you can hear my voice. I'm tired of the stigma. Not everybody's an addict. You label me as seeking. Yes, I'm seeking to be delivered from this agony and pain. I've tried just about everything to try and maintain. Alternative medicine, deep breathing, acupuncture, massage therapy, healing touch, heating pads, hot baths, and meditation. Please don't forget the numerous doses of pain medication. So many transfusions at the risk for iron overload. It's not an illusion, baby. The half hasn't even been told. Don't treat me like a clinical study, although I participated in them. I'm not a lab rat, but both of us have been victims. Stick them, poke them, do everything but choke them. Well, you might as well, because I've been through hell fighting to prove that I'm legitimately in pain. I'm sick when I'd very much rather be well. Sick of living inside this sickle cell, more like living in a sickle hell, because at time I feel in prison. Please set me free from this crisis. To be completely and totally healed would be nothing less than priceless. The pain is increasing and it hurts to sit, it hurts to walk, sometimes it even hurts to talk. I have a loud and proud voice inside this sickle cell. I want to share this awareness, but I have to learn to control my emotions. They have tried just about everything short of magic, spells, and potions. It's not about what I want, but it's about what I need. Labeling me just makes my heart want to bleed, because I need drugs to get relief. You shouldn't think less of me. Contrary to popular belief, you can't prevent me from reaching my goals and destiny. If I couldn't handle it, God wouldn't have allowed it. Satan thought he had me. That clown didn't know that God had me first. I'm letting you know as I get closer to my last verse that I have overcome by the word of my testimony. I'm doing my best to break this generational curse, educating and advocating. This cycle we're in, we gotta start hating enough to start breaking. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. I may have sickle cell, but that's not my name. Ask me again and I'll tell you the same. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. I may have sickle cell, but that's not my name.
Dang. Woo. Come on, SCT.
I'm speechless. I'm speechless.
Thank you so much.
Thank Akia, you for having me on.
Thank you for connecting with me on Facebook and coming to DC. And I look forward to doing so much work with you on this platform that we have. So thank you both. Kenny, thank you, man, for taking time. I know you got things to do, man. It's late on your end of the side of the country. But again, I thank you both. I can't express it enough. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Have a blessed night, everybody.
Thank you. All right, this is WDC Radio. I'm your host. I'm WDC SETD. We'll be back next week, Wednesday, 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time, 10 p.m. Eastern Time. Look out for the post on Instagram and IG at IMWDC. I got a special show coming for you next week, possibly about some insurance issues. So we're going to talk about that. So stay tuned. Rich, thank you, man. Hey. Back there controlling the boards for us. Shout us out. What's the count?
What?
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 Not what. We'll be back next week.
Favorite sport, you know I like the way the dribble up and down the court, fast and slow. 25 years ago, the WDC and it's me, your man Curtis Blow. From Dr. J to Michael Jordan to Kevin Durant, who leads the whole league in scoring. Wayne Wade down in Miami, making a name. I love this game, to the NBA Hall of Fame. Slam dunks, alley-oops, and the give and go. Vince Carter, Superman, and my man Carmelo and Rondo. Over in Boston with the big three, captivating audiences across the country, ruling the world like LeBron the King.
Sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.